The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Good evening and welcome to the Leadership with Biana Kovic show. And thank you for being with us tonight. We recognize you as leaders in your own right and believe that leadership can be learned through consistent practice and awareness. We hope that our conversations will help you become more effective and reflective when it comes to your own leadership practices and enable you to leave a positive legacy. Our very special guest is Cynthia A. Phillips. Cynthia is the founder and CEO of the Disruptive Factory. Cynthia is an economist and agricultural economist, as well as a business consultant for profit and social enterprises with over 25 years of experience in the areas of strategic planning, marketing, branding, analytics, big data, business development, and global expansion. Former Director of International Marketing and Risk Management at American Express, Cynthia consults with technology companies and startups such as Cisco Systems, Bioceri, and Riverbed. Cynthia is a champion of the 17 UN SDGs and supports nonprofit organizations as well as companies of any scale to integrate SDGs into business planning, business intelligence, ESG, and CSR. She is the founder of Global Shift TV, G Media Partners, and the Experience Factory, and the co-founder of Fly Globals. Cynthia, welcome to the show.
Hi, delighted to be here. Thank you.
Thank you, Cynthia. So you are the founder, CEO, and chief creating officer for the Disruptive Factory. And I was wondering if you can tell us a little bit more about your company.
Oh, sure. Well, we love to work with innovators. So created this company to be a really strong collaboratorium. The Disruptive Factory really rests on two pillars. The first pillar is, I really like to call it end-to-end venture and development, where we're actually working with creators and innovators and entrepreneurs to take their idea from inspiration into action, to actually helping them with their strategy, product development, branding, marketing. We have an incredibly talented team that can help end-to-end on any type of project. We really like to work with people who are moving the dial on sustainable industry, bio-based products. We also like to work with technology, fintech is one of the areas I enjoy working in, but also with people who have a product. We work with somebody who has bio-based baby products. Is an amazing entrepreneur, amazing materials innovator. So we work with quite a few different types of people. We work in mobility, smart cities, and just end-to-end of things that make the world a better place. And then the other pillar that we rest on is what we have, the Experience Factory, which is a group of incredible creators and just very smart marketing and branding people. What we do is we create engagement platforms and support innovators in endorsing their platform, helping them to manage their platform for change. So it could be an individual or it could be a group. So we have these two pillars of really solutions-driven storytelling and really making a difference.
So, you know, for me, disruptive means changing the way you do your business. And I would be curious to know, how did you come up with that name?
Well, I think, you know, the word disruptive gets overused a lot. And I think when you are disrupting, you really are changing the conversation, changing the way we do things, you know, to your point. And we want to help people who are really moving the dial on sustainability, moving culture forward, moving things forward in a way that is good for the planet and good for individuals. So what we think of the disruption is it makes you think, it makes you move, it makes you act. And so if we're doing our job right, we're creating opportunities for people to think differently, move differently, and hopefully forward and positively.
And when choosing your clients, what are you looking for?
You know, it's interesting. We have a mix of people finding us and we find them. And it's a conversation that is ongoing within the group that we've created. So we are looking for people who are not in their own way, that they have dealt with their own sense of self-awareness and they have something they really want to contribute. They really feel strongly about it. And they're able to see what they do really well and also know how to ask for help to move forward. We see a lot of incredible innovators, great product ideas or great inventions. And it just doesn't get off the ground because because they need the help on the business side or on the creative side to actually take their business forward. And there's this kind of a silo thing that can happen. What we're looking for are people that know themselves well enough and have confidence in their vision that they can work with others and have that core mission of really creating a good company, a good organization in a holistic way, but also, you know, are driving innovation. So we really like to work with people who like to work with others in a way that really can make a difference.
And the way I understand, you walk people through the process, right?
For the most part, we'll take people from a concept and there's a pathway, a strategic pathway to build a product or to build a service or build a company or even create a film. We'll help people get their film idea off the ground and help them produce things. So it's a matter of being very supportive, bringing in talented people that we know that can help if needed, and really listening to people who want to contribute something special to the world. That's what we're about. We really want to support people to fulfill that. And to me, that creative act is, you know, whether you're creating a way to take organic waste and turn it into a new kind of plastic, we're there with you and devoted every step of the way that you need us.
And you mentioned you also help folks create film, right?
Yeah, so in the Experience Factory, we've got a very special project right now called The Legacy of Light. I myself am a writer-producer as well. And producing, I mean, if you think about it, you know, if you're a really good CEO, you're a producer in a lot of ways too. It's like getting something off the ground and keeping it moving. For film projects that have solutions and telling stories that create a better world or raise awareness, we want to be there to help people succeed. So also to create the kind of infrastructure and what we call transmedia campaigns that really support the movement they're trying to create and really help them tell a good story. It's not easy. It's very lonely trying to be a producer sometimes or being a CEO. And we like to be there for people.
You know, I've talked to a lot of leaders, and my question is, how do you evaluate what matters to you that eventually will sell?
Yeah, and sometimes it's such instinct that what you get in a very canned way is like, here's a problem and here's your solution. And you're looking for a big problem to solve, typically when you're talking to entrepreneurs, and you need to have the right sense of what a consumer might want, whoever your audience is. You need to have kind of design thinking. You're solving a problem, but you also have to be solving a problem that people want solved. And sometimes, although you might be very passionate about one thing, you might not be able to get that off the ground with the right amount of audience. And it's not because you're not right that the problem should be solved. It's just that trying to create all the elements that help people see it the way you do, or just for you to see it in a way that you can really share it properly with other people to get them to come along. I mean, that's the magic and the alchemy for an entrepreneur and for leaders, I think, is put all those pieces together and be self-aware enough to ask, is this just about what I want? Or am I really including everyone in this vision? Because that's the only way we'll get things done, is to really include everyone and bring them along to support and inspire you as a leader as well.
So would you advise that folks, in addition to having this great idea and talking to people, they should also use certain metrics and certain evaluation tools?
Oh, yeah. I love data. You got to measure what matters, and you need to have markers along the way to know how successful you are, because those are creative tools. Data in and of itself is part of a creative toolkit. And never before have we had access to data and the ability to really take it in and make it have meaning and be useful. And also being able to pick up on the sentiment and the behavior of humans and how we interact and how we choose things, you know, where we go, what we're interested in. It's all incredible information that makes it as much art and science to come together and help address things and be nimble enough to address things when you get the feedback and those feedback loops. Kind of exciting to me. I think you need both. And, you know, having a clear goal in mind and then leveraging those kind of tools along the way to get the results you're after.
You know, part of creating a social change is also giving back. And I was wondering, what are your thoughts on that? How do you ensure the companies that you work with will actually give back to their communities?
Well, I think with a good company, and with the way they treat their employees and engage their employees is really important. One thing that I think is really exciting about, you know, if you have to categorize things like millennials and Generation Z, there is an authentic meter, authenticity meter that this cohort has that is like no other. They're raised on social media, they're raised on video and digital, and they're raised on a lot of things that we weren't. You know, I'm a bit older and I was raised in that. So the level of authenticity and sincere engagement of a company matters deeply to that future and present workforce. And companies have really had to step up their game to show themselves and be transparent, and transparency is demanded to be able to keep and attract and keep employees. And it's only going to get more intense as things go on. And I believe that's a really good thing. And I think that there's a lot of good community players that played under a certain set of rules for what defined a good actor in a community. They may be colluding over in small Asian, you know, community or something, but then at home they seem to be all about community and donations. Well, that does not coexist anymore. People know about it, you know, with the tools for social media and everything else. It's just not acceptable to shop from them or work for them. There's that kind of inconsistency for the younger cohorts are just more aware and more engaged on that. So I think that's really terrific for holding more accountability. It doesn't mean that we're all there yet with companies, large or small, but I do appreciate that there are these social missions. And there's something called ESG, environmental, social, and governance dimensions that, like even BlackRock says, you know, the reality is your company does better when you focus on that we're doing the right thing. And that's really resonating for companies. And that can be, like, you know, greenwashed or whatever, if you will, but I don't think so as much anymore because of the kind of tools, communication tools, and transparency that is out there now and demanded by the employees and also external actors.
And I'm really happy that you're talking about employee satisfaction, because what I experience working for organizations, millennials expect something different than what my generation, that is a little bit older than they are, expected. What are your thoughts on that? How do you keep employees satisfied and create that balance between millennials and the folks that have been in the workforce for a longer time and might not have the same expectations?
Well, you know, it's interesting. In the workforce and what you expect out of a company and things have changed, just like some of the things that we talked about. And the nimbleness of a lot of folks, it's no longer you're going to stay in that same cubicle for 30 years and this is who you are. A lot of people can still have that option. There's still that option. But the reality is the younger workforce is seeing themselves as much more nimble and willing to try different careers. There's a whole difference in the labor force. So I think that's a driver of change in the workplace. But there's also wisdom that comes from somebody who has been there 20 years, 30 years. There needs to be better ways of bridging the knowledge and wisdom exchange between those generations, right, or these cohorts. And I don't think that a lot is being done. I don't think people understand that a lot of the most successful entrepreneurs are over 40 when they create their businesses. So there's a lot of wisdom, you know, over 50 that shouldn't be ignored, but should be celebrated and harnessed for good within companies and seen for what it is, and bridging those things, not pitting those groups against each other. And I think a lot more work should be done within companies to have that kind of culture. I call it culture optimization, because everyone should be exchanging and working together and not creating generalizations of each group. Some of the greatest innovators, if given that kind of culture where innovation is accepted and your ideas are accepted, you've got people who've been in companies and factories for 30 years that can actually change a lot of things if they're allowed to have these ideas and share them, if you create that kind of an innovative environment. So I think there's a lot of things that can be done to encourage that and investments that should be made.
And, you know, I agree, because, you know, I think there are lots of great contribution coming from folks 40 and over. But what I think, like, millennials know how to speak up and how to market themselves versus the other group that is more silent about their work.
I think, yeah, that's just a different generation. And I think that's really an exciting point to say, is that that's a skill that needs to be learned for sure.
So how do you create, if you have millennial, and you spoke a little bit about it, but I want to kind of a little bit talk more about it. If you have these two groups, how do you create that balance so that the ones that are doing a great job have a platform to showcase what they're doing as well, with the ones that are sort of talking about it all the time?
I think that it comes from creating those kind of forums of exchange and value, like creating those opportunities for those groups to work together in a very coherent way. A lot of change management, it's that people are siloed and you don't really get to learn from each other. Chip Conley is kind of a movement around the modern elder that's coming out. He speaks to this, you know, kind of the value of the modern elder. There's that role that has been kind of missing in modern culture, Western culture, about really appreciating that role and wisdom of someone who's older in those positions. And I do think that deliberately creating the opportunities for people not to just have, you know, an older person's a boss, but a lot of times a young younger person becomes the boss of the person who's much older than them. I think there needs to be sensitivity around that, because diversity and inclusion needs to be also addressing age, not just the color of your skin or your gender or your other preferences. You need to have a full range of what diversity and inclusion means. And I think this is one element that could be transformational in the American workplace if we get it right.
And I agree with you. Everyone is talking about diversity and inclusion. These are very popular words. But how do you bring that into organization? That's another thing. And some folks actually have voiced in the show that diversity is not really good. What are your thoughts on that?
You know, I think everyone's entitled to their opinion, but I think you need to really look at the data and also jobs that are coming up or in the whole work that's coming. There is more orientation. Diversity maybe isn't required in the old way of doing business. What's required sometimes is that lack of variation in terms of whether you're doing financial analysis. You don't want a lot of creativity in the mechanical way of assembly lines of a lot of things. I lived and worked in Singapore for a while, and people were trained just the way you needed them. And creativity was deliberately, you know, not encouraged. Now, in the new world that we're living in, and I think Daniel Pink wrote a book about this too, A Whole New Mind, what's required now is to have a lot of those characteristics of being able to do, like, the knowledge worker. You have to have empathy. You have to have symphony, which means an ability to bring things that aren't in your sphere, you know, bring them together in a new way. That's all a different set of ways of being in the world, in a sense, and in the work world that is needed now and is evolving and appreciated. So that's an evolution that's happened. So why do you need diversity? Because that requires diversity. Different ways of thinking and learning how to be empathetic and appreciate each other. That's a learned skill. We should be teaching each other at every age to be more empathetic as we can be, to create stronger communities and also communities within the workplace.
But also what you just pointed out is that we need to bring to our management or to our company is something which is called emotional intelligence.
Oh, absolutely. I think some of the best leaders, they may not be able to do the programming that is required for a computer, but their emotional intelligence got them to be a CEO because they leveraged that skill along with other practical skills. But emotional intelligence really is important. And we all can learn. I mean, I have lots of things to learn too. And, you know, we all can learn in that realm for sure. Some people naturally have it, but there are a lot of skills that can be developed around that to at least build your muscle, you know, kind of build your emotional cue muscle, if you will. And I'm not an expert in it, but it just seems that's just what I seem to have picked up.
So in your opinion, when you're hiring CEOs or CFOs, do you believe that someone who has emotional intelligence would actually lead the organization more effectively? And that person should get a job over the one that actually is a tradesman and knows actually, you know, about, you know, moving numbers and stuff?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it really depends what your company is about. I think the best leaders that I've had in my career, and especially at American Express, they were very self-aware, and they were so clear about what everyone's job was that they could appreciate and talk to everybody and check in with them. They weren't above anything. They really understood the business. And that doesn't mean they're going to be able to do Python coding, but they understood the value of each person's contribution. And that employee knew that they were seen and heard. And those are the kind of leaders that were very effective because they also fundamentally cared about the business doing well and had the right skills, the hard skills, but they worked very hard to be aware and engaged as best they could with the given amount of time that you could have. But I was very impressed that this one leader in particular, and he's still somebody I admire.
So being able to hear someone and to listen obviously requires you to recognize that we are all equal, right? And that we all have to have ability to contribute equally. So can you talk to us a little bit more about that, about bringing people together and allowing everyone to shine in their own way?
I think it's really important to understand the strengths of the people that you work with and also the things that they would like to explore in themselves to become stronger in, because, you know, that's just, it's just about being empathetic creatures and putting ourselves in each other's shoes. Not everyone wants to write a press release. We have some people that do amazing communications on my team, but they're essential, but they may not be doing the actual marketing and branding stuff, but they're helping to tell the story out there, and people respect each other. They have different roles and what they can do. So I think it's really important to appreciate each other for what you can build and have that overarching mission and through line about what you're about as a group, but then really having the right people on the team and making sure everybody understands what we're doing together and why. And that's really important in startups and really important in large companies too, because whenever I haven't done well with something, it's because I didn't gather consensus and understood how everybody fit in and launched a large project. And then also the biggest successes I've had are where I've looked under the hood and just asked the right questions to understand that there's an opportunity for improvement on something large. And it actually is because this one thing was never addressed or something like that. So on the one hand, you learn about that. And a lot of times people can succeed without doing either of those things. But I just think success is about holistically being engaged and actually solving a real problem and bringing something positive to the front.
But it also so interesting to me because you actually just talked about something that we actually talk on the show, which is clarity and curiosity. So for me, you were curious to learn or to find out and also had that clarity to put things in place where they needed to be.
Yeah.
So can you talk to us a little bit more about that, the importance of having both when you're starting a business or having a business?
So a lot of times I think we get stuck because we like doing a certain thing and we're curious about it. And we think we have to make it a business immediately if we're going to even try going deeper. And I think it's really important to put your toe in the water, so to speak, and try some things out, you know, instead of trying to create a whole business out of something when you're not even sure that's something that has staying power. So, you know, we can all idealize living on a farm or a working farm or, you know, things like that. And then when people take the plunge, you know, they might do it. Then they're like, well, it's not really what I want to do. So I think it's really important to before endeavoring on a business is to really be self-aware about, you know, is this really what I want to do? Is this something that I can do for, you know, the next 10 years? And sometimes it's like you want to invent something and do something, but it might lead you to partner with other people so that you can do what you like, what you do best in an environment where you're all in the same boat, so and rowing the same way. But you're actually able to do what you are curious about, intrigued about, rather than trying to take on roles and responsibilities that are beyond what you really want to commit to. And I think a lot of founders learn that the hard way, and I certainly have myself. And it's really important to figure that out for yourself. But curiosity is where it all sparks in, and checking in with yourself. I mean, checking in with yourself, if something doesn't feel like it's working, even though maybe logically it looks like it's all good, you need to stop and check in, because if you feel something is off, there is something off, probably. And you need to check in and ask some of those questions to kind of do a gut check and whatever else. But a lot of times we don't pay attention to that intuition. And that's where you plow through with something instead of addressing something that could have been addressed early on, you threw and then you realize you've got a lot to do to make it right.
Another question that I usually ask folks is at which point you kind of say, okay, my intuition is saying to me, I should not continue this, you know, because it could be a fear that's talking.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. I mean, how do you know if something is actually flawed and needs adjustment? And how do you know if it's fear talking, trying to derail your progress? And I think that for each individual, it is important to ask that when you're along the way. I've studied risk management. I always do this because it's just a habit. It's like, what's the worst that can happen? You know, I'll even ask myself and go through those scenarios. And if I can live with it and I'm really passionate about trying something, then it's worth it. You know, in my mind, if there's a resilience around potential failure and so on. But people have different levels of tolerance for failure and fear and everything else. And fear is a wonderful tool, because it helps you learn and it helps you grow. But if it paralyzes you, and everyone always says on their deathbed, what do you regret? You know, it's not what you didn't do. It's not what you tried and failed at. It's that you didn't try to do other things. The stuff you didn't do is what haunts you, usually, is what, you know, people say. And the thing is in this world now, I mean, when you have kids and everything, it's a different world, but it also is a big world of opportunity. And if you can just risk in ways that help you temper your fear and explore, I think that's a good thing. And if you've got to take care of your family and you can't quit your job and you still have a dream, there's ways of trying some things out responsibly. And I think any family that's healthy and functioning wants you to be happy and help you for and give you that hour on the weekend to read something or do something that you really want to do. And that's what it takes to just bit by bit see what's new and good for you. And I think that can be the same thing with people at work. You don't have to go and lead a whole new division to try out, you know, what's it like to be on the risk management team if you're in marketing, right? You could just ask to work on some projects and learn and ask for a mentor. So I think fear can be mitigated by good people around you as mentors, and also not trying to be perfect is a good way to mitigate fear, and being open to exploration and open to failure. I think that's important.
So, you know, I took a training in leadership and they told us that careful leaders are better than overly excited leaders. What are your thoughts on that?
I think there's different personality types. A lot of people misread introverts who are every bit as excited and passionate as that other leader. They just don't express it the same way. So it can be these different leadership styles, you know, different personality types. A very extroverted person can be extremely passionate, boisterous, encouraging, and it excites people, gets people to move along. There's a role for that, for sure. There's a balance. But a lot of introverts, they're as passionate and deeply committed, and it comes out in their work in a different way. And I think it's striking a balance of both things. In some businesses, you need that kind of personality, boisterous, excited personality to make things work, like in sales and other things. And in another way, more measured or quiet, if they're a really good leader, they're going to find somebody who can take that role to work with. So somebody who's more outwardly vocal and so on, that kind of expresses outwardly the passion of the organization to work with, to strike a balance. So a good leader will balance out to have those kind of elements. But I think any extreme has its issues.
So do you believe that every leader is also a good manager?
I think they tend to go hand in hand. If you hire well and have good managers around you, that's a really good skill to have. You should always be looking towards surrounding yourself with people that are, I always like to be around people way smarter than me because it's a pleasure, and people who are self-aware so that they see themselves as valuable and as part of something at every group. So I think a good leader is somebody that identifies people who have some of those kind of characteristics, but also creates an environment for people who are talented managers, and that's what they love to do, who rise and succeed. If you're creating a healthy organization, you should be able to have those kind of managers even rise to be the best leaders in the company as well.
Any thoughts on micromanaging people?
You know, I had an interesting thing when I was working at American Express in risk management. I had a boss once, and he micromanaged me. And I had a PhD, and, you know, and I was a senior kind of person. Not that that matters. It just means I was competent to do the job. And he would want to see things in minutia. And it wasn't about me. You know, first of all, it's not about you. If someone's trying to micromanage you, it usually is not about you. It's about them and their preferences. It was annoying, of course, and I could have made that a real point of dissatisfaction. And then when I realized, you know, this guy has to have a lot of fear that he has to micromanage things. He has a lot of insecurity. And then I felt more compassion, and I didn't mind it so much because I thought, well, if this helps him lead better because he's got the information he needs to allay any concerns, then I'm doing my job in terms of being a good, supportive team member. And different way of thinking about it turned my mind all around. And I don't advocate that kind of style, but I just happened to have some empathy for the guy and turned out to be fine.
So is there a way that you can manage micromanagers?
I think that's a really tough thing. I think there's a lot of training you can give. And I think as a leader of somebody who is a micromanager, it's good to just have conversations, like ask questions. Do you think that kind of oversight might make Susie nervous? Or do you think you're getting the best result from Susie if that's what you're doing? You know, do you think you could try a different style? Asking questions and not accusing is really important. Sometimes people don't realize they're even micromanaging. They have no self-awareness that it could be seen that way or feel that way.
And what I'm hearing, like you saying to us, seek to understand.
Oh, yeah. And also sometimes, I mean, you know all these stories from kids in school that when things weren't diagnosed with like dyslexia, you would just assume somebody's lazy or something like that. If somebody's not able to do something the exact way you want them to do it, that's kind of like a control thing, right? And that all stems from fear or lack of understanding. But sometimes people, you know, they're doing a good job. And for most people, what they've done is just fine and it's good for the organization. It's just not what the micromanager might want. And if you have a healthy environment where people can give feedback, and I think it's good for an employee to say, you know, I don't really think about doing it that way. I might need some training. I think a lot of times people don't realize how they're coming off, just a lack of self-awareness.
As someone who has your own organization, giving feedback is a big part of managing folks. So my next question is, how do you give feedback to folks that are more on the defensive end?
First of all, feedback is a two-way street. And feedback that is actionable and constructive is what feedback is. and have some empathy for when it's delivered. I ask for feedback from my team often. There's a call or something, and I'm like, how did you think that went? Any feedback for me? You know, things like that so that we can keep learning and growing. And if you can always feel when something's not quite right. But when people are defensive, I try to turn it to the positive. I'm like, really glad we're having this conversation, because why don't we create something that just is clearer for everybody? Like, no one's wrong. It's an opportunity to get on the same page so things run more smoothly. And I think it takes a lot of skill to get everybody on the same page and also respect them as individuals and everything else. But I think when people are really defensive, usually that's from fear or they don't want to be told they're wrong. So I don't think anything's wrong. I just think that there's an opportunity to improve communication and make things more peaceful. So that's how I usually approach it.
And what I'm hearing also, it's the language that you're using. Like, you're very positive in your communication.
There's something that I think Maya Angelou said, which is people won't remember what you say, but they will remember how you made them feel. I think language is really important and it has to be authentic, but that's something to learn over time, I guess. But it really is, I think, a very true adage.
You mentioned authenticity, and for me, authenticity is a very interesting word, because some folks are authentic a little bit more on an aggressive end, and they say that just me, just take it the way, you know, I am. What are your thoughts on that?
You know, the golden rule is a golden rule. You know, do unto others as you would have them do to you. And I think that good communication is a big part of it. And being empathetic is super important. Trying to put yourself in somebody else's shoes is super important.
We have a lot of entrepreneurs listening to our show, and you have a very impressive background. You actually have currently 3 companies that you are CEO of. How do you create that balance working 3 different jobs, if you will?
Well, I am a weird one. I mean, my brain is very strange, but since I was a little girl, I've always liked to do a bunch of different things at the same time, which used to drive my grandmother Miller crazy. We'd watch television, knit, and read a book at the same time. But I think that level of adventure and curiosity, and I believe in people. I believe in these entrepreneurs. I believe in every partner, client, and I believe in the team. And I can't think of anything that motivates me more every day than supporting people to be the best selves that they can be in their work. That's where I think I can really make a difference, is being that person to help champion others. So that's what motivates me with every entrepreneur. And as an entrepreneur myself, is that if I'm asking someone to help me, I want to make sure they can succeed at it. And likewise, if someone's asking me to help them, I want to make sure I'm present and there. And that can mean doing a bunch of different jobs to help them along. And to me, that's a privilege.
So what you're saying to us, you're kind of tapping into all your skills and all your resources and customizing towards the need of your clients.
Absolutely. Well, my team does the same thing. There's no one way when all these things coalesce together to be able to get to where somebody can get to the scale or what the vision that they have for themselves. So I think that's really important. And one of the things that I think is really important too is leadership is a privilege, an absolute honor and privilege that people want to follow your lead. And it is extremely serious business to me personally, because people are trusting you as a leader with their future. They are asking you to help them move into their future. And that's really a serious enterprise. And it's a privilege and it's a joy. And I don't forget that every day, you know, that it's an honor. And it's an honor to serve other people, for sure.
So you're a very humble individual.
I'd like to think so, but I'm sure I could be a real pain. No idea. I don't really know how to answer that. All I know is I feel really, really, really grateful to have the skills that I have. And I'm really grateful that, you know, I get to work with the people I work with every day. And sometimes we all slip up in things, but I feel really, a really neat time to be on the planet. And yeah, so I'm really grateful. So I'm grateful. Maybe that's why it seems humble. I'm very grateful for everything.
Any thoughts on generosity and leadership?
There's a balance between generosity, selflessness, and self-care that I have only recently been working towards. I burn myself out sometimes because I just have this drive. And that's not really generous if you're burnt out and you've got to take yourself out because you're too stressed out. So I think there's really a striking a balance of understanding what is generosity. And taking care of yourself is a way of being very generous to people, because to be fully present when you're with someone is a very generous use of your life. And you can't do that. You can't be fully present if you're burnt out and you're not taking care of yourself. You have to have that balance, because I noticed that. I couldn't be completely there for some folks because I was so preoccupied with some things. And that's not the right way to be. When you're with someone, you should be with someone and give them your full attention instead of being distracted or whatever. So I think that self-care part is really important to learn.
And also, I would say setting boundaries.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's really important. Setting boundaries to be absolutely concerned without being responsible. Otherwise, you just get completely unbalanced with how you can help somebody.
So what were the strategies that you used to bring that balance and put those boundaries in your life?
Well, I think I learned from a lot of mistakes with being too invested. I am happy to say, I think this is a great year. I've learned a lot, and it's always going to be learning. Is who you choose to work with makes a big difference on ability to balance. Because I tend to be very empathetic, I would choose to really work with people that it wasn't a good fit because my level of empathy wasn't a good fit for their success. And so now, I have to say, in the last year, I really feel good about the choices of who to work with and not doing stuff just for money. I try to do stuff on mission. But, you know, it's a mix when you've got people to take care of and stuff like that. But I think for me, choosing who to work with more carefully has made a really big difference because you only have so much many hours in the day. And I always kind of take on a lot and figure I'm resilient enough to manage it all. And I figured out last year that's not true and that I need to have a better balance. So I've been focusing on the upfront assessment, grounding assessments, and then really making sure clearing communication and working in that realm to really set the right foundations for a great relationship. And I have to say, I just love the people I work with. And I love the entrepreneurs I work with as well and the team. So I really feel good about that.
And also what I'm hearing, it's okay to say no to certain opportunities.
Yes, no is a good thing to learn for sure. And I think a lot of people say that. It is true. That comes from self-awareness, having self-care. I think it's a really important thing to have. There's something called like a somatic or embodied wisdom. And there's a gentleman named Scott Cody who does a fantastic course called, the Institute for Embodied Wisdom. Great teacher. And really, it's about checking in. Your body tells you, you know, when things are off and if you pay attention. And, you know, that little twinkle in your gut when something's off or you kind of know you have a red flag and you ignore it. So I've been much more mindful of those somatic clues and that embodied wisdom approach to running meetings or groups and also making decisions. Like really checking in for awareness.
I want to kind of circle back on self-care because, you know, some folks would say, I don't have time or look at that as being selfish. Can you talk to us more about it?
Well, you know, I think it's interesting because that really is something that I'm committed to and, you know, vocally and telling folks that, you know, I'm really trying to have more self-care, which means body, mind, and spirit. And I think we don't have the time not to experience true self-care. You know, it's quite the opposite. We have to invest in it, just like you invest in your house. If you don't do certain things in a house, it's going to break down. And I have some really good habits, but I can always do better in terms of taking care of myself. So those are the things to think about. For example, I travel a lot, and I chose not to travel a lot the last 4 months. And it's been really transformative in terms of just a reset on being more aware and checking in so that I can take better care of myself and make great decisions. And it's not like a whole overhaul I've done. I've just made sure that I've slowed down a bit, and it's made a big difference in my quality of my life. In my relationship.
And it almost seems to me you allowed yourself to create that space so that you can kind of think about and make the decisions that are more aligned to where you are today.
I'm just grateful I did, you know, choose to do it. And I have a situation where it makes it easier for me to make those kind of decisions. And I'm aware of that. It really is a real pleasure to have that and a real opportunity to create the life I really want. And self-care has to be part of it.
Are there any traits that a leader needs to have to be a truly successful leader? And you talked about it. I just want to kind of do a summary of it.
Well, you know, I'm still learning. So there's a humility of being a student. Know that you're always going to be learning to be a good leader. And that kind of curiosity of how to improve. Empathy, for sure. Understanding your job, you know, understanding your business, really not thinking that you don't need to dive into some of this stuff. I think really understanding the business because that shows the respect to everybody in the organization. So if you really understand your business and how everyone contributes, that's probably one of the most beautiful characteristics I've seen in action. And I was at American Express, actually. I was so impressed by that. And I also think that there's just self-awareness. Having a sense of that leadership is a privilege actually helps orient everything, I think.
And also keep growing and learning, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You're reading something new or doing something new. And I mean, that's life, isn't it? I mean, it's not just work. Throughout your days, you should always be growing and learning. That's what the science says. That's how you stay healthy. And I think your organization is going to be healthier if you're a leader is curious and self-aware, for sure.
And another question I have for you, I mean, you obviously have gone through reinventions, and I was wondering, why do you think that reinvention is so important in our lives?
Reinvention could be that you're shifting an orientation to be able to have a life much more resonant with your hopes and dreams. And I'm still learning. I mean, one of my big things that I put aside for a long time that I'm picking up again is creative writing. So I'm trying to take my own advice and try bit by bit to work writing into my day and into my week. And I have different writing projects. And so bit by bit, I'm putting that more into part of my life that will kind of keep evolving there and making more room for it. So that is a reinvention of how I might spend a couple hours in the day, right? But I'm choosing to do things that are very meaningful that I don't want to put away anymore. I want to bring them out.
That's very interesting. I never heard that concept before. So basically what you're saying to us, you can continue doing what you're doing, but bring some other things parallel to what you're doing.
Oh, yeah. That's why the Disruptive Factory has these elements of, you know, hardcore venture development, and then the Experience Factory, which you have the story, solutions-driven storytelling. So all those things come into play. None of them are not needed if we want to create the world we want. So that's why I think it's kind of a holistic approach, and one's life is a holistic approach too, if we're going to live it well.
So do you believe that every good leader is a great storyteller?
I think it's interesting because I've always felt that a good storyteller pays attention to detail and has a sense of their audience. And I think a lot of leaders are great storytellers. I think a lot of them are or will be called great storytellers. But I think people underestimate the value of story in a business well-run and happy customers, and that very maybe uncelebrated, more quiet leader, that's an art to create a company that really works. And sometimes people forget the act, how every budget tells a story, how a company treats its employees is part of the story. So I think sometimes the storytelling comes through as a collective manifestation of a person that sees the whole, that could be that CEO. And that's a beautiful story to tell of a company well-run, employees that are happy, and customers that have great respect for a brand. So there has to be an element of storytelling in that, the soul of a CEO that creates that environment.
So what you're saying to us, the storytelling becomes a part of company's culture.
I think so. What employee doesn't like to be part of that company's overall story? And then there's also the kind of canned way you're trained, the people get trained to be big leaders with the big, you know, here's my story. And they learn how to tell stories, you know, and give the talk and stuff like that. But I think the most successful ones are the true, authentic ones. One of the best leaders, I think, in the world and in my generation has been like Ken Chenault, who's the head of American Express. And he was never flashy, man of great integrity and dignity. And when the 9/11 hit and the financial world was in crisis, he was a moral, graceful authority figure and leader in that community for rebuilding. And I remember that, and I was always so proud to work with him as a leader. You know, so it was really kind of interesting. So his whole way of leading, he has a full story of the customer, of the employee, and what a brand stands for, that I always thought was very, very measured and inspiring. So I was very proud to serve under him.
So do you feel that a good leader is even-minded and even-footed in everything that he and she does?
I think how you make decisions matters. You know, you should be able to be very consistent with how. To me, that's what even-footed is that you have a process that there's a fairness to how you do things, and that's not a mystery to the people around you on how decisions get made and things. So I think that's really important to be transparent that way. I think as a creative process, when you're brainstorming, it's good to have that freedom and space to think about a lot of different things. But once you're trying to take people on a journey, you have to be consistent and sure-footed and open to changing directions in a way that is thoughtful and inclusive.
And what is your mission in life?
What I like to say is I feel I'm really here to create opportunities and to empower people and organizations. If they have a calling, to be there to support them in articulating their gifts and bring their gifts to build a world that's more just and sustainable, if they're called to do that, I just want to be there to be able to give the tools and encouragement and to really help people be who they feel called to be in terms of really if they're called to do something great in the world. I mean, if you want to be a great mom, I want to do something to help you, you know? So I want to help people be all that, to create the world they really want. That is just and sustainable. So that's kind of my mission.
And any final thoughts for us?
a really lovely conversation with you. And I just think gratefulness is just a really core part of living and being for me. And I think it's important to be able to say that out loud and be proud of it. I think gratefulness and empathy and things like that are a strength, and being able to talk about them more openly is a real pleasure. So thank you.
Thank you so much. And then how can people learn about the Disruptive Factory, contact you, or participate? I know you guys have events too.
Well, you can find us at www.thedisruptivefactory.com, and we have a blog, and we have an amazing group of people that you'll meet on the website that are awesome. And then we do like to participate in different events. We have something called the Disruptive Exchange, which is like an invitation to collaborate in different cities and things like that. So we're trying to do more of those types of events. But people can just feel free to text, email. I think LinkedIn is an amazing tool. I get the most interesting things happen when I open up my LinkedIn, so definitely love people LinkedIn to me. But also, you know, our team is amazing, and there's a lot to share if you come to our website and stuff and just get in touch with us. We'd love to hear from you and see what you're up to.
Thank you so much, Cynthia, for being a guest.
Oh, thank you. It was a nice opportunity.
Thank you. Our special guest was Cynthia A. Phillips, CEO and the founder of the Disruptive Factory. And with that, thank you for tuning in and listening to the Leadership with Biana Kovic show. If you like the show, please follow me on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Instagram. You can also listen to the past episodes by going to the Leadership with Biana Kovic YouTube channel. Until next time, be a leader that you're born to be, and have a great night.
keep you bleeding, begging, it's not here in the mountain pie. Well, don't you dare laugh out loud, take away what you got.
Thank you.
dizzy, felt like rain.